Okay, well, that was a fascinating lecture. We go from Barry to Gary Smiler-Turner now. It's not every day you get to hear from a professional sportsman, certainly not one who has not one or two or three world titles under their belt, but 13 world titles in various fighting arts. Okay, now I've been getting to know Gary a little over the last year, and he is one of those people who will pretty much try anything. You know, if you suggest a technique, he doesn't really ask, does this fit in with my current model and thinking? He will test it, he will try it, and I admire that about him. So he's a sports performance expert specializing in fighting arts. He's also a therapist and personal trainer. Now, I know, because I've had a glimpse of the sheer volume of content in his talk, that this is going to be fast-paced, hence the request, if you are going to volunteer, just to get your hand up or come down here. Pay attention, take notes if you need to. There is going to be, it's going to be like a tour de force of information coming at you. So please, let's have a big hand for Gary Smiler-Turner.
Thanks a lot, Anne. Cheers. Cheers. Every year, I think it's around October, Arnold Schwarzenegger has a show called the Arnold Classic. It's a big fitness expo. They have the bodybuilding, obviously with Arnie, all the weights, all the weight competitions, all the figure competitions, and lots of peripheral sports as well. A few years ago, he opened with Friday Night Fights, and I had the pleasure of being the opening fight against Carter Williams, the USA K1 kickboxing champion, to open the Arnold Classic and the whole fight night. And it's quite a big arena, and it was a big show, big event, as you can imagine, with Arnold being there. It was good to have his name on the check at the end as well. It was quite a big do, to say the least. And I'm just backstage, and I've got Carter Williams over on the right, ready to walk out with his smoke on the right, me on the left to go out. Me and Carter have done our usual thing. Hey, Carter, good luck. You're in front of a home crowd. You too, Gary. I know you're away from home. Do your best. It's a friendly sport that we do. We kill each other, but we're still friends. It's a funny set. Carter shouted out, you gonna do the same as usual? I went, yeah, winner or loser? Loser buys. Brandy okay? Yeah, loser buys the brandy, okay. And then we're just about to go out and fight and basically brain each other. It's just the way it is. I'm just about to do my walkout and I've suddenly got a microphone, a camera in my face. And this reporter, this Japanese reporter says, Gary, you're just about to go out in front of Arnold Schwarzenegger and 18,000 people in the stadium. We've got around 3.5-4 million people on pay-per-view. How do you feel with all of these people looking at you? First thing, I'm just gonna go out and perform for my life, yeah? It's not perform, you know, Tiger Woods, what happens if he misses this putt? Oh, he loses out on a bit of money. If I miss with my jab, the chances are my head's off my shoulders, especially with an opponent like Carter Williams. So what the hell was she doing asking me this at this point in time anyway? But I did, I answered honestly. I said quite clearly, I don't care. I don't care about 3.5-4 million people. I don't care who these people are. What I do care about is the person in front of me, because I have to pay attention to the person in front of me, because if I don't, I'm not going to be paying attention to what I need to. And off I went and fought. Fortunately, this time, I got away with drinking the brandy all night on Carter. But basically, I'm here in front of my leading peers. I'm out of my comfort zone. There's no one here, hopefully, that wants to hit me. If they do, good, put me back in my comfort zone. But if you guys aren't hitting me, I'm well out of my comfort zone. I'm here amongst some of my leading peers, some of the people that I really, truly respect. I've really, really enjoyed Barry's first talk, and I know we've got some really good stuff later on. Not only that, some of you guys in the crowd, I really, really respect. And it's like, hang on, you're all looking at me. Yeah, so I'm gonna make mistakes, I'm gonna cock up, yeah, I'm gonna go off on tangent because that's how my mind works. So when I do, just laugh with me, yeah, with me, not at me, with me, because it's gonna happen. But hey, let's start as we mean to go on. I just need, for a bit of fun, I need a volunteer. Someone stick their hands up. First person stick their hands up. Give me somebody, come on, here you come. Not sure how many people would do this. This is a nod to James Tripp. Okay, watch out, James. I've now morphed into James Tripp, but on speed. Okay, you left or right-handed?
Right-handed.
Right-handed, straight arm, up like that. Bend your wrists. That's it, bow it down. Okay, pinch that between your finger and thumb. Find the spot on the card. Look at that spot on that card. Continuously look at that spot on that card. As you continuously look at that spot on the card, just squeeze that thumb and finger together. Continue to look at that spot on the card. As you look at that spot on the card, I want you to imagine your finger and thumb becoming locked and stuck together, tighter and tighter and tighter. Imagine that finger and thumb becoming locked and stuck, tighter and tighter and tighter. Imagine it happening automatically, so much so that even if you wanted to let go, it would just lock and stick tighter and tighter and tighter. What's more stuck now, your finger or your thumb?
Say it again.
What's more stuck now, your finger or your thumb? What feels more stuck?
I don't know, both.
Both. Imagine every time I click my fingers, they double and stick tighter and tighter and tighter. What's that like right now?
Well, it's stuck.
It's stuck? How'd you know it's stuck?
Because I can't let it go.
You can't let it go. Here's the thing, I'm gonna take this hand here, I'm gonna put this hand on your head, I'm gonna push down this head. Can you feel your hand pushing into your head and your hand pushing into your head?
Yeah, I can.
That's brilliant. Now, you know what that feels like, don't you? The finger and thumb stuck together like that, yeah? Now, I want you to imagine there's a fast-sitting glue, something that's binding that together, so your hand's becoming molded, stuck to the head. Imagine it becoming locked and stuck, locked and stuck, locked and stuck, just as much as the finger and thumb on that card. What's that hand feel like now? What's more stuck, the fingers or the thumb? Sorry, the fingers or the palm?
Probably the fingers.
Probably the fingers,
yeah,
probably fingers. More stuck. So imagine what you need to do to make the palm just as stuck, just as locked and stuck as the fingers. Imagine what you need to do when the palm's just as locked and stuck as the fingers. Then maybe the fingers can lock and stick tighter and tighter and tighter as well. And what's that like right now?
Feels all right, I guess.
Feels all right. So what I want you to do is that hand, that card would only drop only when you can have that hand completely stuck to the head. So you'll easily and effortlessly be able to drop that card only when that hand is completely and utterly locked and stuck to the head. And go ahead and try and drop that card. And that card will only drop when that hand is completely locked and stuck to the head. Cool. What's that hand feel like now?
Yeah, it kind of feels stuck.
Brilliant. Try and pull your hand off. And what happens when you try and pull your hand off? What's that like?
Yeah, I can't.
You can't? No, close your eyes. Close your eyes. I'm going to go for a leap of faith now. Close your eyes. Now, what I want you to do is inside, make whatever changes are necessary. Make whatever changes, with a little nod to Jürgen Rasmussen here as well. Make whatever changes are necessary so that when you open your eyes, I'll be completely invisible. When you open your eyes, I'll be completely invisible. You see right through me. You will not see my clothes. You will not see anything to do with me at all. You will be able to see right through me. I'll be completely invisible. You'll be able to hear me. You'll be able to touch me. Please don't touch me. You'll be able to touch me, but you do. I'll be completely invisible. And that hand will come off the head only when your unconscious has made whatever changes are necessary inside so that I am completely invisible. And go ahead and make those changes inside now. And when those changes are complete inside, then your hand will easily and effortlessly come off that head. We'll just go inside deeper. As you go inside deeper, make whatever changes are necessary. Whatever changes are necessary so that when you open your eyes, I will be completely invisible. And only then will that hand come completely off your head. This is having a different result to what I wanted.
Hey, because I still can't take it off my head.
You still can't take it off your head? Try. Try and take the hand off your head. Not now, but in a moment, I'm going to go further. I'm going to go a little bit further to move it along. Not now, but in a moment, I'm going to say one, two, and click my fingers. When I click my fingers, that hand will come easily and effortlessly off your head, and your head will have made whatever changes are necessary so I will be completely invisible. One, two. What was that like?
It was kind of weird. Annoying.
Kind of annoying?
Yeah, I guess so. But I felt all right, but I need to
pick
my fingers.
This isn't quite going to plan for me. Can you see me?
No, I can't.
No, you can't. So what happened before?
I don't know. Like, do you know when your vision is blurry?
Yeah.
Yeah, kind of like that.
Damn, I'm messing it up. This is not supposed to happen. Those feet are my feet, they're my feet, and as they're my feet, they're now stuck to the floor. Those feet are stuck to the floor, so much so that as they're my feet, you can try and move them, but they're not your feet, so you can't move them off the floor. Try and move your feet.
That feels about right.
Oh, for God's sake! Not now, but in my own, say one, two, and click my fingers, and I click my fingers, the feet will be back to normal. One, two, move those feet. Give them a big hand.
Well done.
No, not well done.
Probably well done.
Honestly. That actually didn't go to plan. So Harry, Kev, Marcus, I'm really, really sorry. It didn't go to plan. I wanted to cock up. I wanted to fail. Yeah? I mean...
Well, it was all right.
I
felt good.
I think it was... I'm like... Hang on, this has gone too... No, he's not reflecting the periphery. You know, his areas of brain working on the motion detection aren't working. It's like... I'm bloody invisible, aren't I? To go from a card stick to a hand head stick and then go to invisibility is quite a big step. And that's kind of... I actually got unlucky there. I actually wanted a bad subject, but I guess that you're a good hypnotic subject. You've been hypnotised before and the rest of it.
Well, I've had... Oh,
cool. Well, I guess that you're one of these guys with a gargantuan rostrum there. The idea was, I wanted to fail. I wanted to fail. Why the hell would I want to fail? One, it gets it out of the way so that everything else that I'm going to do if it cocks up is quite okay, because I know what it feels like to be a failure. But also, you learn from mistakes. It's all about pushing yourself. If you push yourself and go past the boundary, it's only when you go past the boundary that you actually find out where that boundary is. This had disastrous effect for a friend of mine, Andrew DePorus, on Jersey. We're playing around on his jet skis. I was giving some seminars out there, and he decided to roll the jet ski several times. Only problem was his wife was on the back. And when he then said the saying, you don't know where your limits are until you've exceeded them, she hit him. So fortunately, I didn't do it in quite the same way. But basically, it's all about pushing yourself. It's all about pushing yourself. As Anne says, he gives me an idea, I'll go out and play with it. Not only that, I've had a recent idea, just putting two and two together and three and four together and making 16 and... Well, will that work? And I've been testing it, and it started to work. So there's someone like Craig Galvin, who's like a total maverick. And I say, Craig, have this idea. Go and play with it. And he gives me loads of feedback. He's even worse than me at just testing things. It's all about testing things. If you stay within inside your comfort zone, you're never going to get better. You've got to reach outside and keep on going through your comfort zone. And that's what my whole approach to fighting. That's, I think, why I've been successful. I've also had some very good mentors, as I'm having some very good mentors in hypnosis. And some of you are in this room and you know that, you know who you are, how you've been leading me. It's been great. Much appreciated. But hypnosis is a funny thing, because for me, I'm not even sure if hypnosis exists. Interesting. I'm not even sure. I'm talking at hypnotism conference. I'm not even sure if hypnosis exists, because I can't find a single study. I thought I had. James actually discussed it through with me and I realised, no, I haven't. I haven't found a single study that shows hypnosis actually exists in itself. There's a hell of a lot of studies that show the results of hypnosis. But I can't find anything that actually says, this is hypnosis. This is a neurological state of hypnosis. It's just not out there. So I'm starting to think, does hypnosis actually exist? For me, I don't rely on faith, okay? I don't rely on faith. I have belief. Belief based on tangible evidence. And at the moment, I can't find any tangible evidence that hypnosis itself actually exists. So I'm reserving judgment until such time that we do find it. But at the moment, I know that when I do these various rituals and things, I get the results. And it's the results that are important. I mean, just with a nod to James, I used the hypnosis without trance methodology on our friend here. That's the methodology, but it doesn't really matter how I stick the card to the hand, or the hand to the head, the feet to the floor, or make myself invisible. That's going to look so good on video, thanks. The one time I don't want to look good, you make me look good. Yeah, it doesn't matter on the methodology, it's all about the results. If I can find some method of getting that card stuck to that hand, that's all I want. I can do the classic reality is plastic, fingers together, magnetic palms, dropping the arms, sleep deeper, deeper, deeper. Yeah, the classic way, ramping up the phenomena, moving from one thing to the next thing and on. You know, let's go for a physical, followed by an emotional, followed by an amnesia. Hey, now I can get anesthesia. Yeah, I don't care how I get there. I'm just going to go for the hit. I want to get the result. It's all about the result. So basically, I play around. I use traditional hypnosis. I use relaxotherapy. It does have its places. I had a chronic pain client during the week who I looked at her and thought, okay, let's give it a go. Her imagination wasn't that good, and I couldn't quite get the imagination, automatic imagination model to stick. I'm still playing with that. I'm really looking forward to their talk later as a result. It wouldn't really stick, so I dropped her into a trance. I use progressive relaxation. In doing so, I taught her how to relax as well, which would be of benefit to her immune system anyway, and taught her how to relax as part of the induction. I use hypnosis without trance a lot. I use anything that I can make up that gets the results, basically. And most importantly, I blend it together in freeform. I freeform to make sure I get the result, because that's what it's about. If I've got a paying client in front of me, I want to get the result. And in a fight sport, they really need the result, because if they don't get the result, they're going to get hurt. Okay? As I said, what's the worst thing that happens if Tiger Woods misses the putt? He loses a bit of money or position. We get shins wrapped around our heads with a force of a baseball bat. If we make a mistake, we know about it. It's a serious game, so we've got to get it right. It is all about the results. That's just my take on it. How do I get to the results? Any damn way I can. Okay? One of the things I looked at recently, I'm a geek, I read a lot, neuroscience, cognitive linguistics, psychology, sports psychology, clean language, and numerous works of my peers and any other ideas that come along, I'm constantly studying. I've also got a couple of crazed huskies. I'm possibly the only hypnotherapist that I know of that actually has a husky in the therapy room while I'm doing work. Great. You try, got an anxiety client, mine's racing too fast because they come anxious, they can't listen to a word you say. You can do the juggling ball technique, for example, or getting a stroke a husky. No one can feel anxious while stroking a husky. Also, especially when I'm playing with the automatic imagination model, quite often little Max, my little husky's got a unicorn's horn running around the room, which is a quite good test for my client's hypnotizability. Maybe he's got a nice large rostrum, or she's got a nice large rostrum, which would be handy. So I mix everything together, okay? But this thing, I study on about the dogs. I told you I got off on tangents. On about the dogs, I also study canine psychology, canine behavior, and canine neurology, because there's lots of serendipity. What I've actually found is, if you want to learn neuroscience, you can get books like John Ratty's book, The User's Guide to the Brain, or Rita Carter's Mapping the Mind, which has updated John Ratty's book and added things like the latest mirror neuron stuff. It was like October 2011, I think, the latest edition came out. And what that does is gives you a lovely base on neurology, which I think we should have if we want to be good hypnotists. But then I've actually found that by studying canine neurology, they put things in such a way it's easily understood. And I've learned so much more from reading the canine stuff. So I'm mixing stuff together. And I had this one afternoon where I was just listening to AIM on the way to sparring. Got hit on the head a few times, which always helps with the thinking process. Coming home, I listened to another tape. Then my canine behaviorist friend gave me a call. And suddenly, hang on, 2 + 2 = hey, hang on a second. All of us have the multiplicity of personality. We all have multiplicity of personality. We all have multiple personalities within us. Multiple personality disorder can be termed when one personality is out of touch with the others and may not even know that they or other parts persist. Again, Rita Carter's book, Multiplicity, has a lovely little description of the multiplicity of personality. To put it into real world times, the you that's here today is different to the you at work, different with you, the family, different with you playing sport. Would that make sense? Little different elements of your personalities come out in different contexts. And you can use a metaphor that you've got little elements of your personalities that pop out at various times. In the field of neurolinguistic programming, they call them parts. Parts of your personality. You know, I want to stop smoking on one hand, but the other side makes me want to keep smoking. Now, it's only me, so you've got two separate parts. One side that wants to smoke, the other side that wants to stop smoking. Make sense? And I thought, hold on a second. I've just been listening to a lovely Andrew Austin tape on working with insomnia, and he turns off a voice. When you're at night and you're trying to sleep, and when you're trying to sleep, you're having little arguments in your head, you know, like you had an argument with a boss that day, and in your mind you're role-playing, part of your personality is taking on the role of your boss, and then it's your argumentative self, and they're having this little Barney, yeah? How can you sleep when one of you's shouting and the other one's being shouted at? So, hey, let's stop that cycle. Let's turn off one of those voices. Now, hopefully you've heard of submodalities. Submodalities are subsections of your sensory modalities. For example, sight. If you close your eyes and think of an apple, the apple will appear to be floating around somewhere. It'll either be 3D or flat, have color, various. There's various submodalities attached to the modality of sight, attached to that modality of imaging. So he uses a methodology of playing with what I now term the critical voice. They will say critical voice, it's the same thing. The modalities, the submodalities of that voice. And what he does, he just turns it off. Just a thought, just a demonstration of this. Has anyone, if you want to close your eyes a second, and just think, if any one of you has a negative voice, just let me know, just so I can give a quick demonstration of how to apply a very simple submodality change to a critical voice. And I can bring it straight back for you as well. It's not therapy, it's a demonstration. So does anyone have a voice? You know, that one that says, you can't do this, or something that's nagging. Has anyone got one of those voices? See your hands up if you have? Come on, just volunteer. Someone volunteer for us who's got a negative voice. Okay, cool. Close your eyes a second. And can you hear that voice? Now, if you were to see that voice, what would that voice look like?
Like a green small man.
Like a green small man. See, a psychologist's field day. Where did that green small man come from? I don't care. I'm going to work with this green small man. So this green small man, can you still hear the voice in your head as you see it now? You've shown me with the hands, but if he was going to be in this room, whereabouts would that green small man be?
It's then close to the banner.
Cool. Now, in your mind, only in your mind, because there's not really a green small man down there, but in your mind, I want you to go over there, get some black duct tape, and slap it on his chops. And just nod your head when you've done so. And what happens to the voice when you do that? And what happens to the voice when you've done that?
It's gone squeaky.
It's gone squeaky. Put some more duct tape on it so you can't even hear a squeak.
Yeah, it's dull now.
It's dull now. Now, in a way that's right for you, I want you to go over there in your mind and give him a shoulder hug, or give him a rug, a hub. A hub, a rug? A rub or a hug, pat him on the back, yeah? Give a kiss on the cheek, whatever's right for you that you find comforting. And say, okay, I've heard you. You're not really helping matters. Just be quiet now. And again, just nod your head when you've done that. And what happens to the voice when you do that?
It's gone.
Cool. Open your eyes. Look, Max Wall. Just make you think of something else. Okay, close your eyes. What happens now when you think of that voice?
Sorry?
What happens now when you think of that voice?
Doesn't want to come up.
Doesn't want to come up. How weird is that? Now, just out of interest, was that voice of benefit to you in any way? In which case, I'll leave it to you and your choice. Should you wish to take the duct tape off, please feel free to do so. If you'd rather the duct tape stayed on and that voice stayed quiet, again, I'll leave that up to you. So you have that choice of either bringing that voice back or not. If you take the duct tape off, the voice will come back. If you leave the duct tape on, the voice will stay away. You can then choose that. And I'm going to continue with the workshop now. Workshop, seminar, presentation, whatever you want to call it. And you can just decide on that and just open your eyes when you're ready. So the critical voice is nothing more than I've elicited a voice of that part of the personality. I've elicited the voice and I've just changed it. I've changed it from a sound to a visual. What would that voice look like if you could see it? Normally it would look like a part of me. Oh, it looks like me. Yes, but what sort of me is that me? It's an angry me. Oh, because it's that element of your personality that has that voice. Now, you can go into a whole realm of working with various parts with that, reframing the voice, making it nice and positive. And you know, there's a whole field that you can go into. Those of you that do hypnotherapy or NLP or are used to playing with parts and parts reframing or reframing generally, you can have a field day with those elements and really make it a positive voice. If you want to, you combine and bring them together, do a visual squash as well. But the simple methodology is change the voice's submodalities. So if you could see that voice, what would it look like? If it was in this room, where would it be? Duct tape it. Make sure it's not in reality. If you're having an argument with your wife in your head, I don't want to be sued for saying put duct tape on your wife. And then just tell it to be quiet. I've heard you. Acknowledge it. I've heard you. You're not really helping matters. So just be quiet now and just relax. Turn that critical voice off. What I noticed and what the ping moment that popped into my head was when you do this and try and drop that card, what happens? every street hypnotist's worst nightmare. You've just gone out, it's the first one of the night, you want to get a good hit to give you that confidence, that boost, and the Muppet drops it straight away. Using James's technique that he taught me, straight away utilise it. And what happened there? Well, I just knew I could drop it. You just knew you could drop it. How did you know you knew you could drop it? Well, I just told myself I could drop it. Oh, you told yourself you could drop it. Close your eyes. Let's turn that voice off. And we started playing with it, the critical voice, that part of the person that's in touch with reality. And what I've been finding now is I can drop someone into hypnosis just by turning off, eliciting and turning off the critical voice. That critical voice that's in touch with reality. If you've got no voice inside your head or part of your personality telling you what's real and what's not, why wouldn't you take what I say when I'm telling you that is real? Just a thought. I've used it conversationally. I've used it in that methodology more overtly. And Craig Galvin's even been doing it on Skype and by text. And it's been having some really good results. Now, it's not standalone, although I have used it standalone. However, once you get a failure, it's another option to turn a miss back into a hit. My suggestion, though, is, as with the demonstration, has this voice got any positive benefit? And I've left it to him whether he wants to turn it on or turn it off again. Okay, your choice. If you're doing it in street or therapy, the chances are that the voice that's in touch with reality is kind of important. So you might want to bring that back with the right reframing as well. Now, change work. Basically, I play around with the plasticity of the brain. Brain's plastic, it's liable to change. Every thought that you have is making new connections. Every stimulus that you're being received is giving you new connections. It's always moving. Your memories are only of the last time you access that memory. And then it gets relayed down again. Reality is not real anyway. It's only your perception of reality. I think it's not like 1.4 million rods and cones at each eye. So basically your eye seeing 1.4 megapixels, something like 35 stutters per second, little micro saccades per second. So you're taking in 94 million pieces of information per second, going through the visual areas of the brain, gets cross-referenced against your entire schemas for life, your life's memories. These are genetic memories, your genetic coding, your emotional memories, your episodic memories, little episodes of your life, like your little journey here today. You have a little episodic memory of that, how you got here today. You have your procedural memories, which are a big thing in sport, the automaticness of throwing the punches and kicks, the handwriting, the tying shoelaces, riding the bike, your automatic responses. Also your semantic memories. Your semantic memories, your knowledge base, Battle of Hastings, 1066 and all of that. And just out of interest, who knows what happened at the Battle of Hastings, 1066? Okay, we've got a couple of history geeks. And the rest of us are over the age of 30. Everyone under 30 has probably watched horrible histories. All the kids know. I don't. The kids know. So basically, what I do is change the reference material. It's your reference material that gives you, that tells you how to act in the present. You receive a stimulus, gets cross-referenced against your schemas. Your schemas are made up of all your memories. Your schemas are your life strategies, how you deal with things. A restaurant schema could be go into a restaurant, get seated, Give your order in, food gets brought out, you eat, you pay. You don't just walk in and go, yeah, what food you got, I'm hungry, and start making it yourself. You have a schema for a restaurant. So your life strategies are little schemas as we go. So your reality, James sees me now, goes through all that processing, gets cross-referenced purely against his life's memories. That then gives him the image inside his head. Okay, so it's doctored, his experience is doctored by his life. That gets laid down as a memory. So even if initial memory isn't reality, memories then change. Every time you access them, they change. So what I do is I change the reference material, the memory, to give them something more beneficial. I give them future memories as well as past memories so they can act in the future in the right way. When a client comes in and sees me, I don't take case histories. I don't believe in case histories. Okay, there's a very good reason why. I found that when I started taking case histories, it actually had no relevance to what I needed to do with the client, because quite often it's a conscious interpretation. Oh, conscious, unconscious, I hate that metaphor. In awareness, out of awareness. I really hate conscious, unconscious. I can't get the grips with it because it just doesn't, it's not true. Classic one for fighting. I want my fighters to have mindless violence. I want them to be mindless violence. I don't want them to think. I just want them to act. Sense the target and have already connected. And they're aware of it afterwards. The classic study by Libet, replicated by Wagner, not the guy from X Factor, though that would be funny, and more recently, my favorite neuroscientist, Ramachandran. Basic description, gross generalization, both hands on the leg, brain scanner on, do I lift my left hand or do I lift my right hand? Half a second before the left hand moves, the motor cortex fires up to move the left hand, then the left hand moves, then the area of the brain that makes the decision makes the decision. A full second after the decision already been acted upon. So consciousness is nothing more than a metaphor. It's a commentary on what we've already decided to do unconsciously based on our life's memories. So when a client comes in, I ask a simple question. So what are we here for today then? They then tell me exactly where I need to go. If you listen to the words they use, their uses of the pronouns, their identity terms, I, me, you and self, for example, they tell you exactly where you need to go. And I freeform it from as they tell me. I then deal with things as they come up. If someone comes up with a metaphor, you know, it's like I've got this black cloud following me. I'll go straight in the clean language world. Oh, black cloud. And what kind of black cloud is that black cloud? And I'll knock it on its head there. They always give me the entry. My client sessions have got so much easier since I've learned to listen to my client. My client, in NLP, they've got that horrible presupposition that a client has all the resources that they need. They don't, but they can tell you where they need the help, which is the important thing. So, most important thing, though, is results. I just test, test, test. I continuously test all the way through. It's all about the work, okay? It's all about the results. So the only way you know if you've got the results is to test. Has someone been hypnotized? I test. Your hand's stuck. I can't move it. Try and move it. I can't. Got to move it. I can't. I dare you. Double dare you. Double dare with knobs on. If they can't move it, I've got a good idea they're hypnotized, okay? How do you know if they're hypnotized? Test. How do you know if you've got results? Test. Now in sports, there's a large element where you need post-hypnotic suggestions. I have had clients where I've hypnotized them and they've been performing in hypnosis. But the majority of the time, that's just not practical. I'm really interested in Adam's talk on self-hypnosis. It's self-hypnosis, isn't it, you're covering? Yeah, because I want to bring some of that element into my work so they can actually enter into hypnosis for it and not rely on post-hypnotic suggestions. Because as Barry's been saying, not everyone's a great hypnotee. I think that's Barry, that's your term, isn't it, Barry? Hypnotee? It is, yeah? So a good hypnotee. You don't get, not every client's a good hypnotee. Not every client will be able to follow a post-hypnotic suggestion to the letter. Not only that, you've also got to be careful that your post-hypnotic suggestion as given, and with the intent that it's given, is received by that person. Because their interpretation of it may be completely different. So post-hypnotic suggestions you want to do are very, very important. So if I'm working with a sportsman, with an athlete, I will look to make them a good subject. If they're a good subject, brilliant. I can hit them with these post-hypnotic suggestions, I can test them. I'll give you amnesia for this, but when you come round, when you come out of hypnosis, I'll say to work a fuffle, you'll have an undeniable urge, from my voice, only today, only in the confines of this room, to lightly scratch your nose for a second, and you won't know why you're doing it. I test that they're following a post-hypnotic suggestion. How do you know if post-hypnotic suggestion stuck? Test it. Because I want them, from the moment they step foot inside that cage, from the moment you step foot inside that ring, the moment your gum shield goes on, all of these suggestions will hit home instantly, effectively, and unconsciously. They will just happen. Because I want mindless violence for a fighter. I don't want them to think. I just want them to act. I want to have the procedural memory of this stimulus, this reaction, this stimulus, this reaction. To automatically allow all the strategies to take place. Easily, effortlessly, unconsciously, doing exactly what they need to do at the right time in the right way. First thing on sports people is it's not just about the sport. It's about their life. If you don't clear up the crap around their life, you're not going to get an athlete focused on the task at hand. If they've got home trouble, if they've got work trouble, for example, then they're not going to be focused on their sport. So you can clear that side up as a whole separate set of sessions, and that will have great results on their athletic performances. So I look to do a life-sport balance as well. So work with the client's underlying issues of how they live their life, because you can clear those up. Generally, you're going to get a better athlete anyway. And then I come to the sports performance. I basically want them to act automatically. I want them to have a stimulus, and when they recognize a stimulus, then I want them to react automatically. When I was explaining this to my clients, a friend of mine, Martin, said, you want us to do mindless violence? I thought, cool, I'm going to nick that. Now, I attach emotion to everything, absolutely everything. okay? You have a stimulus, you see something, okay? Oh, makes you afraid. You see a stimulus, it could be a thought as a stimulus. That'll send a signal to the amygdala and the limbic system, the emotional center of the brain, which will have a little electrochemical spark. That little electrochemical spark is all that an emotion is. The emotion will then send a signal down to the brainstem and other autonomic areas of the brain to create a feeling in the body representative of that emotion. That feeling is nothing more than chemical reactions and body fluid movements. We don't have enough fluid inside our bodies to carry out all the functions. The feelings move. For example, the stimulus is a lion coming at you, hungry, drooling. Your amygdala fires up with fear. The adrenaline as a neurotransmitter fires up. Rah! Electrochemical spark is emotion. Now the feeling comes on in the body. The feeling will normally be a feeling of anxiety, the stomach churning, okay? There's lots of other processes going on, such as the DHEA, cortisone, adrenaline pumping around the body, your heart and lungs faster, getting much faster, the blood moving from the skin. Everything is getting ready. It's getting ready for the freeze, flight, fight, fear, faint response, the extended general adaptation syndrome. It's there to save you, to motivate you to move away from something. So a lion comes at you, electrochemical spark of fear brings on a feeling in the body. That feeling is there to motivate you. Negative emotions will close you off and tense you up. Okay, that's their purpose. Protecting the ventral sides, the groin, the organs, the face. It will close you off. Okay, positive emotions will open you out. If you look to Ekman's work on facial the facial structures associated with emotion, he's actually done a lot of studies where if you form the facial structure representative of the emotion, you'll actually have the emotion as well. It works two ways. Your emotion will bring on the physical position, and the physical position will bring on the emotion as well. Now, negative emotions are there to move you away from something. Negative emotions bring on the feeling of closing off, adding tension in. Now, if you're a tennis player, you're not using tension, you're using relaxed technique. The only elements of you that are tensing are the ones with the fine motor skills designed to deliver the exact strike on the ball in an exact follow-through in the exact way. If I'm throwing a punch, there's no tension involved. There is zero tension. You pop it out from the body, and this arm's basically relaxed. It's completely relaxed. If I'm feeling a negative emotion, oh, I'm afraid, I'm adding tension, because that's what my feelings do in my body. So you have a stimulus, brings on an emotion, brings on a feeling in the body. That feeling's there to motivate you, to protect you, or to make you feel good and open up and relax. I want people to get into a state of flow. So I look for positive emotions rather than negative emotions. Now, emotional control and regulation. Control, as I was rightly told by a PhD lecturer friend of mine in sports psychology, control in science is a switch, on, off. It's a digital, yeah? Switching it. Regulation is turning the dial. Regulation is turning the dial, shades of gray, okay? So emotional control and regulation is highly important because you need a sports person to be in the right state of mind. If they're in the right state of mind, they're therefore in the right state of body. Or conversely, you can get them in the right state of body and then that will give the right state of mind to be able to perform at their sport. To do that, you've got to control and regulate their emotions. Because if you can't control and regulate their emotions, they're going to be tensing up and locking off. They're going to be basically not allowing themselves to get in the right fight state, because it's happening autonomically. Emotions happen autonomically. Okay, gonna quickly go on to a very quick demo. Does anyone have a negative feeling they can bring up? Anyone? Negative feeling about anything? Anyone? 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 Yay! Can you bring up a negative feeling? Okay, close your eyes a second. Okay, just close your eyes a second, only because it just shuts out the rest of it, the rest of the world that's going on. And can you think of that thing that gives you that negative feeling? And can you bring that negative feeling on in your body? Can you feel that feeling? Now, All feelings, of course, are on the body because it's a somatic experience of an emotion. So as you feel that feeling now, if it had a colour, what colour would it have? Black. Use your mind. Change it to something more appropriate, maybe a warm yellow, a cooling blue, or a natural green, something more appropriate for you. Just nod your head when you've done so. Cool. Now, as all feelings are nothing more than body movements, I know that that feeling is moving. As that feeling is moving, can you notice which way it's moving? Okay, so as you notice which way it's moving, I want you to slow that movement by half. And just nod your head when you slowed it by half. Use your mind, I know how strong it is. Cool, slow it by half again. Slow it till it stops and get it moving in the opposing direction. Cool. Now, I want you to shrink it by half. Again, use your mind, I know how strong it is, and just shrink the size of it by half. Shrink it by half again. Shrink it down to the size of a pea. Again, just let me know when it's there. Is it there? Cool. Now take that pea and put it about 3 feet out in front of you. Just nod your head clearly when it's done. And now fire it off in the distance. So far, it just doesn't want to come back. Cool. And just lightly open your eyes. Come back in the room. And what happened to that feeling during that? Oh, it's out there. And that's, how does it feel now? Very light. So it's not the same feeling then. Cool. This is a somnambulist. Adam, if you want a subject later. She's dropping off. The eyes are flying like a good. Thanks very much. You okay, yeah? All right, now, that's just a simple methodology. It's good old Richard Bandler and his spinning the feelings. All he's doing is using a metaphor, a way of working. Turning the steering wheel on a car. You don't need to know all the linkages that take place for the actual wheels to turn. You just know you turn the steering wheel and it works. So that methodology is quite straightforward. It's quite simple. Changing the submodalities of it. And basically, what you end up doing is using a little methodology to use your mind to control the fluids and blood flows, etc., in your body. Fantastic. So if you change the colour to something more appropriate, it's not the same submodality. You've changed it. If you change it to something more appropriate, you're really taking off the emotional content of it as well. If you then slow the spinning, notice by half, by half, by half, little gradual baby steps is a lot easier than saying, reverse that feeling. That can tend to be a step too far. You're actually changing the feeling. You're starting to change the emotional reaction by changing the feeling in the body. If you then shake it smaller, 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 you're reducing that feeling. I take it down the size of a pea. It's not feeling anymore, is it? It's a pea. Suddenly it's dissociated anyway, even though it's inside your body. Pop it outside your body, now it's dissociated completely. You're not going to have that feeling. Fire it off in the distance. It's a nice way. So if you've got someone, a sportsman that's getting anxious, you can teach them that technique. And after a while, they can just do it automatically. After practice, they can do it automatically, and it will just take control of that anxiety nicely. Because you can't handle every anxiety for that client. But what you can do is teach them strategies of how to deal with it. So what you do is basically, if you want the feelings to go, you want anxiety to go, just shrink it, stop it moving, reverse it. But if you want to make a feeling good, so if you want a guy to get a right good buzz for the elite, you know, it might need to get really up, you want to get energized, he wants to get ready for it. Get the feeling. Make it bigger, spin it faster, make it brighter, bolder. It will bring that feeling on and help get them to that fight state. So that's one way, a simple way of regulating emotion. Interestingly, if a client finds it hard in a client session to get an emotion that you need them to get, you can use that methodology, of course, as well in therapy to help them bring on that right feeling. You can do, I tend to work multi-layered the whole time, loads of things happening at once. Now, just want to introduce you really quickly. Does anyone have anything negative from the past? Something's happened in the past that, when they think of it in the present, they have a negative feeling about. Again, you won't have to tell me anything about it, but I just want to give a quick demo of how you can work with something like that very quickly. Does anyone have anything? Kabolia, quickly, if you can come out for a second. This is a nod to Andrew Austin with Integrated Eye Movement Therapy, a 23-year development on eye movement desensitization reprocessing, EMDR. Works a treat. Close your eyes. As you close your eyes, can you think of that thing from the past? I don't need you to tell me anything about it. Apart from, if you're going to call this emotion a name, what emotion would you call it?
Fear.
How do you know you have this fear?
It affects me.
It affects you. So it affects you in the body, I guess.
Yeah.
You get that feeling. And that feeling, is that feeling there now?
Not when I'm just standing, but I can make it come.
Make it come. Make it come as you think about it. Let me know when it's there.
Yeah.
Get it up as high as you can. And on a scale of 1 to 10, what's it like now?
7.
7. Cool. I want you to hold on to that memory. There's a memory associated with this, isn't there? So as you hold on to this memory, I want you to open your eyes and look at my finger. Keeping your head perfectly still, hold that memory in mind. If the memory fades or jumps, go with it. And if the feeling fades, try and bring it back. So you're going to follow my finger, keeping your head very, very still as you think of that memory. So you've got that memory in mind? Cool. And just follow my finger. Head still. Keep thinking of that memory. And if the feeling fades, try and bring it back. Head still. What happened during that?
Feels better.
It feels better. Close your eyes. Get up as high as you can. Get that feeling back as high as you can as you think about that memory. And how high can you get it now?
4. 4.
Open your eyes. Keep thinking of that memory. Keep thinking of that memory. If the feeling fades, try and bring it back. What happened during that?
It decreases.
Hey, decreases.
Yeah.
Close your eyes, get it back as strong as you can. And what happens now when you try and get it back as strong as you can?
There, but it doesn't feel as bad. Maybe 2.
Okay, open your eyes, look at my finger, keep holding that memory in mind. Keep looking at my finger. Look smart from. This is therapy. Those in the crowd have got a smiley face on my finger. What happened during that, apart from seeing a smiley face on my finger?
It kind of changed. It changed the negative aspect of it. Partly because this one makes me smile, and it also take over the feeling.
Uh-huh.
It's still like some memory. It's good as a protecting mechanism,
yeah.
But it doesn't feel as bad now.
Oh, cool. Close your eyes. And on a scale of 1 to 10, how bad can you get the feeling now?
One.
Cool, grab a seat.
Yeah.
Thanks very much. Oh, sorry. Oh, hand!
thank you.
Sorry. Cheers. That's very quickly IEMT, a very basic algorithm from IEMT, Integrated Eye Movement Therapy. Now, both of these, I've just given you two examples of things that you don't need hypnosis for, but they also work brilliantly inside of hypnosis. They're part of techniques. I'll chat to you later about how that works and the methodologies of that, because I'm going to run out of time. I'm always going to run out of time anyway. So basically, if you've got negative emotion, if you've got past experiences, a fight came in last week and said, yeah, I can't get over this last fight. Well, why can't I get over this last fight? It's in the past. It's called the past for a reason. Past is the past. He says, I can't. I'm carrying it with me. Well, what are you carrying with me? The shame. I lost. I can't get rid of that shame. I lost. Everyone saw me lose. Yeah, but everyone's got to lose. Not like this. I got knocked out first punch. Oh, how do you feel about that now? Shame. What happens now? Can't get the shame. It's in the past. It's gone. Take the negative emotion off the past performance. Now, I'll then reframe it and start saying, okay, as you look at that time now, What would you do differently if you did it again? Take away the negative emotion from the past experience. Now they can look at it objectively. Now get them to look at that time objectively and ask them, what would you do differently in the same instance? And then I start using mental rehearsal, which is far better, of course, with hypnosis, because you actually put them into that situation. They can actually see, hear, feel that overall experience. You can really bring it out of them. And then you get them to do it a different way. You get them to do the right option. So if they slip to the left and walk straight onto a Southpaw cross, you can have them slipping the other way to slip off the punch, for example. And again, you're starting to build a new reference experience for them to work from. So when the punch comes again, they'll be taking the right option, not caught up in the past. So emotional control and regulation, I do a lot of. I attach emotion to everything. So whatever I do, emotion, the army say motivation is motion through emotion. It's a regular coaching term from the Army Coaching Leadership School. Motivation is motion through emotion. You have a stimulus, gives you the emotion. That emotion brings on the feeling in the body. That feeling motivates you. That feeling mobilizes you. Negative emotion moves you away from something. Positive emotion moves you towards something. So I'm constantly working to attach emotion to everything. You know, I get this feeling sometimes that I just don't want to go to the gym. I'll give them negative emotion about that. Make them feel guilty about it. So they want to go. I then attach a positive emotion to actually being at the gym. I put a negative or positive. If it's something I don't want them to do, I attach a negative emotion to it. If it's something I want them to do, I'll give them a positive emotion. Now, the whole thing is basically to work on getting a flow state. I want a state when they're just working completely, easily, effortlessly, unconsciously, making the right choices in the right way at the right time. Whatever sportsman you've got, whether recent weeks, rally co-driver, who needs to stay calm and focused as he's bumping around all over the place on this, giving the instructions to his driver, you know, a tree's bearing down at him at 70, 80 mile an hour, he can't take his eyes off the notes to see whether they're going to hit the tree. He's got to keep focused on the notes. I want them to have the focus and attention on the task at hand. We all know what they want to have happen. They want to win. I get them to focus on what they need to do to make that want happen. Okay? What they need to do. Then most importantly, I check that they've got the tools to actually take those steps, achieve those needs, and make that want. I'm going to jump on to... Yeah, little things. Time distortion. Let's cover time distortion. Time distortion is something, because I know my time's running out, so I'm going to quickly fan through things. Time distortion. I use time distortion with all of my athletes. We've only got perception of time. We can't see time, touch time, can't feel it, can't hear it, can't taste or smell it. If we can, that'd be funny. Synesthesia kicking in. But we can only have a perception of time, our perception of time. We all probably have the experience of a good thing going really, really quickly, a bad thing going very, very slowly. Okay, we code time in our brains, we code experiences with time. I will regularly use time distortion. For example, let's go back to fighting. I'm 41 now, someone gives me a call today, I could be fighting at whatever level in 6 weeks' time, that's no problem, it'll just take me 6 weeks to get ready for it. But I still train, you know, had a massive sparring session yesterday, hence why a little red mark there. I don't get off every punch. But I want to get basically, people are saying I'm faster than I've ever been. But physically, I'm slower, far slower. I'm faster because I see what's going to happen. I sense what's going to happen before even my opponent does. I go back and look for every nerve, every muscle, every tissue, every fiber, everything that tells me something's about to happen. I'm three breaths back. Fighters will have a regular movement. They'll settle, sharp intake, sharp outtake. I will know that moment when they switch from the regular breathing to the settle. And that's when I attack, before I've had a chance to bring in the sharp intake, the sharp outtake. So you only breathe out on a punch. Not only that, because I'm studying exactly how their body shape is, exactly where their posture is, exactly where the tension relaxation is, their physiology, I'm seeing everything about them. So at the point when I see them go from the regular breathing to that moment of relaxation, I know exactly what they're going to do. Is it going to be a punch? Is it going to be a kink? Kick? Is it going to be what punch? What kick is it going to be? How's it going to come out? I know. So basically, three breaths back, I know what they're going to do before they do it. So I make sure that I build in with my clients this element of time distortion. I take them into an experience, whatever the sport is, and slow everything down. Get them to see everything in fine detail, moment by moment. Work out where that start is. And to do that, I use time distortion. I get them to slow everything straight down and then see themselves working quicker than their opponent. This is terrible because I'm running out of time. I've covered about a third of what I wanted to get through today. Okay, so I've gone through it quite quick. I actually got thrown right at the start with the car stick, the hand stick, the feet stick, and the invisibility. Interestingly, it's really good in the peripheral, and it came back in the focus first, which I found quite interesting. That's my inner geek coming through. That was supposed to totally cock up and put me at ease, so I kind of ranted on a bit. As I said, that's about a third of what I wanted to get through today. That's probably about a hundredth of what I do with my sports clients. I have no products to sell, okay? I have no products to sell. Unless you're an athlete that wants to come and see me, okay? You'll probably have a good idea on therapies, and there's quite a few therapists here, so I'm not going to pick up any therapy clients. If you're an athlete, yeah, by all means, come and see me. However, you'll have my contact details. Contact me. If you've got a sports athlete coming in and you want to know in various approaches, for example, or how I do something, keep in contact. It's not about what you know. This is what I've learned. It's not about what you know. It's about who you know that knows it, so you can ask them. So use me as a resource, guys, yeah? I'm here in front of you today, bearing my all to you, basically saying, if you think I can help with anything, ask. I've got no interest other than you guys getting better. And by doing that, because of the way that my mentors have been with me, I know it's going to pay me back in the end. It's going to pay me back in knowledge. That's going to get me better. That's going to help me to where I'm going to go. So we have some questions in a moment, but thanks very much, guys. And over to Uncle Adam.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thanks, Adam.
Cheers, Gary.
Thanks, mate.
Great.
Oh, shit.